So let me continue our discussion on brains. Yesterday the brains, now brains again. Let me first summarize my first lecture. Let me remind that I have tried to argue that when we consider the usual high-dimensional gravity, there are non-trivial solitonic-like objects, which are brains, so hypersurfaces, which generically could have p plus one dimensional world volume. Their main properties are they have non-trivial non-zero tensions, non-zero charges, and charges are different. They are not our conventional electric and magnetic charges. These are charges corresponding to high dimensional, high rank gauge fields. And the next point, which I would like to stress once again, these are stable objects. Their stability is natural for solitons of any kind. And here is the example of stable object. And when you consider parallel brains embedded in high-dimensional space-time, they do not interact with each other. And if they are at rest, they do not interact. This is extremely important point, which could be used to model the different field theories on the world volume of the brains. So the first point, which is important. Theory on brain. This is non-trivial theory which involves gauge field. Let me remind that gauge abelian gauge field appears when we take into account massless degree of freedom of photon coming from open string. There are several scalar field which correspond to embedding of brain in the external dimension. So scalar field, Higgs-like field in our theory, in the brain paradigm correspond just the coordinate of the brain in the high dimensional space-time. And when you consider a set of parallel brains, for instance, NC brain, here we have the non-abelian situation. Non-abelian correspond when all brains are on the top of each other. It corresponds to UNC gauge theory on the world volume. And the Higgs mechanism corresponds just to taking one or different brain from the rest of them. So this difference between brains is nothing but vacuum expectation value of the Higgs field. These properties of brain are most important for me in what follows. And to formulate the gauge string duality, which is the main purpose of my lectures, I should tell a few words about the gauge side of the correspondent. Here I discuss several important features of the brain or solitonic stuff in the high dimensional space-time. So let me add one more important point. There is a non-trivial consistency condition for propagation of solitonic or string or brain in the background. So it can be phrased as follows: quantization of string or brain in external field is to one-to-one corresponding to classical equation of motion for external field. This point also is very important, and actually to some extent it was the motivation for Polyakov to invent a lot of ideas related to gauge string duality, which was culminated by Moldacena. Okay, so let me now say a couple of words about the gauge theory side of correspondence. And in what follows, I'll compare the gauge theory, which is, with the solitonic stuff in high dimensional space time. So, I should explain the most general features of supersymmetric gauge theories, maybe in 10 and 15 minutes, but so it sounds strange, but nevertheless, I'll try to argue and demonstrate what are the main features of the corresponding gauge theories, which will be compared to the theories on the brains. Okay, here I'll start with the supersymmetric gauge theories. And there are a couple of theories which differs by different amount of supersymmetry. Let me remind that supersymmetry is the symmetry which connect the spin properties of the operators with the translation in the space-time. So it relates the properties of the translation in the space-time and translation between fermion and bosons. I have no time to describe the features of supersymmetric transformation, but nevertheless, let me explain what are the field content in different theories, and in what follows, I'll mainly focus on so-called maximally supersymmetric gauge theory, and in the next lecture, I'll discuss how the gauge string duality could be applied to QCD. Okay, so let me start with for the n equals 4 supersymmetric Young-Mills series. 4 correspond to number, its so-called extended supersymmetry. And what which fields are involved in this theory? These are non-abelian gauge field. Let us assume that we are dealing with SUM gauge group. And what is important is that there are six real scalar fields, phi I, one to the six, this scalar field corresponds just to coordinate of embedding our four-dimensional space-time in ten-dimensional space-time. So there are six additional coordinates, and these additional coordinates are nothing but scalar field in our world. There are the same amount of fermionic degrees of freedom due to, I do not want to enter details about the fermionic sector of the theory, but the number of fermionic degrees of freedom is the same as in bosonic. So this is spin one, spin one, spin zero, and this corresponds to spin one half. And the number of spin one plus a number of degrees of freedom zero equals to number of spin one half due to supersymmetry. Okay, so what are the main properties of the corresponding n equals 4 supersymmetric Yerkes-Mills series? The Lagrangian is quite simple, but it's quite lengthy, and I'll try to avoid these lengthy formulas. Okay, so what are the features of the theory? First of all, it has zero beta function. So beta function correspond to running of the coupling constant, and in this theory, the loop contribution from from bosonic particles completely cancels the contribution from the fermionic particles. So this is a conformal theory. And another important point is that how many vacuum ground state you have in the theory? This is a key question. And in this theory has infinite number of vacuum state. Also, important point is that what are the stable particles in the theory? These are so-called dyons, which has some amount of electric and some amount of magnetic charge. So this is the spectrum of stable particles in n equals 4 supersymmetric Yerkes-Mills theory. Let me note that the beta function corresponds to running coupling constant, but another object in the n equals 4 theory could run. For instance, when you consider anomalous dimensions, this theory has very non-trivial anomalous dimensions. Okay, so this is the most general feature which I'll what global symmetry this theory enjoys? I guess everybody in the audience recognizes the symmetry. Symmetry group is SO24, which is nothing but group of conformal transformation in four dimension. Another part is you see that here we have six scalar and they enter the Lagrangian on the equal footing. Therefore, there is SO6 group of rotation of the scalars, which is the symmetry of the theory. So, there is some terminology. Maybe let me just mention. This is so-called R-symmetry in supersymmetric Yerkes-Mills theory, which rotates colors. Okay, so I guess it's enough for n equals 4 supersymmetric Yerkes-Mills theory. Let me say a few words about the rest of the theory with less amount of supersymmetry. When we consider n equals 2 supersymmetric Yerkes-Mills theory, it has once again gauge field, but now instead of six scalars, there are two scalar fields, 1, 2. Beta function, the coupling constant is running now, and beta function is one loop. Has one loop contribution. And once again, infinite number of vacuum state. There is no conformal symmetry since beta function is non-zero. And instead of SO6, SO6 R symmetry have less R symmetry in this case. So this theory, by the way, was solved in a very beautiful manner 20 years ago by Zyber Witten. But you see that it is far from our four-dimensional world. So let me make the next step. Consider n equals 1 supersymmetric Young-Mills theory. And in n equals 1, once again, we have gauge field. But there are no scalars. No scalars in the theory. Once again, we have fermionic degrees of freedom, and the number of fermionic degrees of freedom equals to the number of bosonic degrees of freedom. And now it has finite number of Lapland states for SUNC, NC minus 1 vacuum states. And you know that when you consider, when we have different vacuum states in the theory, you have new object from the very beginning, which are identified as the domain walls between two. So it has non-trivial domain walls, which divide vacuum 1 and vacuum 2. This is a new feature of n equals 1 theory. And the final point which I would like to mention for n equals 1 theory is that beta function has all loop contribution, but it is exact. So beta function exact, but all loop contribution.
What does exact mean?
Exact means that the answer is known. So I could write down beta function looks as follows. So I do need some constant, alpha s squared 1 minus c1 c2 alpha s squared. Alpha s. And this is so-called ns vz beta function. It was, by the way, it was derived by in ITEP. This is example of use of quite complicated mathematics in a very physical manner. This object counts some topology of the space of fields, but on the other hand, it can be it was obtained in a very tricky and physical manner. Okay, so this it's enough for n equals 1. Let me complete this list. The usual Young-Mills of UCD. We have beta function is for sure all loop contribution, but now we do not know its exact form. And we have the single vacuum in the theory. At least it's common belief that there are no multiple vacuum in the usual conventional QCD. So there are no domain walls. And however, there are non-trivial condensates, which I will discuss in the last lecture. We have new object, so-called quark condensate, and trace and gluon condensate. So the vacuum, in spite of there is a single vacuum in the theory, there are quite non-trivial strong coupling phenomena in this case. Okay, so let me complete. So I guess I told a couple of general features of supersymmetric vacuum structure of supersymmetric Young-Mills theory. Of course, it's necessary to have additional lecture course to explain each step in this logic. But nevertheless, I hope you get some flavor on this stuff. Okay, so now let me turn to formulation of the Greek string duality, which is the central for our lectures. To some extent, we would like to compare the information on the right blackboard. So we have phi I, I 1 to the 6, and beta function equals to 0. These are most important points, and infinite number of vacuum state. Why we are looking at the most general supersymmetric Young-Mills theory, because it's the simplest one. Of course, reducing the amount of supersymmetry, we enter the more and more complicated situation with non-trivial strong coupling phenomena. Okay, so let me remind the symmetry, conformal symmetry, it is SO, SO6. Should I comment on this on the group?
Yes.
Huh? Okay. So the meaning of this group is very simple. So let us consider the following quadratic form. Consider the following quadratic form. It can be written in this way, or some intervals, infinite intervals here. This is the symmetry, which is the symmetry of the following quadratic forms. Here there are four pluses and two minuses here, and you will see that this structure corresponds to. To the anti-de Sitter space. And I guess it's clear what which symmetry SO6 corresponds to.
Maybe you can tell it the same as SO4 and the quadratic form.
It's just the rotation of six scalars. So here we have four-dimensional space-time, and we have additional six dimensions in 10 dimensions. This is just the rotation of transverse coordinates from this time. So let me emphasize that since now we will live on the world volume on the solitude. So everybody should feel the new ideas about this point. So now let us assume that our four-dimensional world volume, the conventional, our Minkowskian four-dimensional world volume, is our four-dimensional series are just series on the world volume of solitons. So these guys, let me write down a little bit more here. Let us assume that this is the soliton in higher dimensional space-time, so-called D3 brain, which means that the world volume is 3+1 dimensional. So we believe that we are living in four-dimensional space-time. Therefore, from the solitonic viewpoint, we are living on the soliton four-dimensional object embedded in 10-dimensional space-time. And I have already mentioned that when we have NC D3 brains, we have and fix the center of mass of the stack of the brains, we have SU and C Gaishivri on the world volume. Let me turn to the key idea about the duality. So let us assume that we have stack of these three brains, and I have already mentioned that any solitonic brain has non-trivial tension and non-trivial charge. What does it mean for our picture? It's clear that, well, when we consider the particle, massive particle, it's clear that it deforms the space-time around itself. So the usual particle, conventional particle, is the source of gravitational field. The same is for brain. I have mentioned is that instead of mass, here we have tension of the brain, similar to the tension of the string. And this means that we should immediately claim that brains deform metric around themselves. And the question is how this brain deform the metric around themselves. The second question is, I have mentioned that these brains have charges. This means that at any charged particles, it create additional field, which is analog of magnetic field to some extent, around itself. So charge, this means that it's external, produce external field around. I have mentioned yesterday that when you consider brain of different dimension, it produces around itself, due to the conventional Gauss law, the field of, but it's now higher rank field. So this is the field mu 2, mu 3, mu 4. This is a field with four indices, so-called some terminology. Four-form field. It's clear that it fits with our dictionary, which I discussed in the previous lecture, that the brain is the source for P plus one form field. That is why here we have four indices here. So the stack of the brain produce, once again, we could use the conventional high dimensional Gauss law and introduce the field F with five indices, which is the curvature of this field, so in differential form, it can be, it has five indices. I hope that this notation are clear. We just take the derivative of this field and take the antisymmetric part of this stuff. So we have non-trivial matrix. So what we have, what non-trivial we have around our stack of brains? We have non-trivial matrix. The gravity is described by matrix as a matrix, and the tensionful brains produce non-trivial metric around themselves. And second, it produces the higher rank electric or magnetic field. And what is important, it is cell dual. In 10 dimension, let me write down mu 5 epsilon symbol mu 1 mu 10 and f 5 mu 6 mu 10. So it enjoys the property of cell duality in 10 dimensional space time. This is the picture of a specific feature of D3 brain. It equally can be considered as a magnetic and electric object. And what is the metric here? To get this metric, it's necessary to look carefully on the solution to Einstein equation in this solitonic background. And this analysis has been done by, I guess, first of all, by Maldacena. And the answer is as follows. If we consider a very large number of D3 brain, it deforms the 10-dimensional space-time in a very peculiar manner. And it turns out that the corresponding space-time in the background of the NC D3 brain is nothing but ADS5 times S5 geometry. To be a little bit explicit, let me write down the metric for ADS5 times S5. The matrix looks as follows. It is R squared is written here, the XI and Y coordinate belongs to ADS5. So in 5-dimensional space-time, we have a non-trivial metric here. And the rest of this formula correspond to a simple metric for a 5-dimensional sphere. So we see that our soliton, where we live on, so we are living on some soliton, and this soliton amounts to non-trivial metric around our four-dimensional world and non-trivial field around our four-dimensional world. And let me also write down the expression for the metric. For the radius. Radius goes as follows. Here we have some dimension of a constant. This is dimension of a coupling constant. G, Young-Mills, it is just conventional Young-Mills coupling constant, which correspond to interaction between gluons and gluons and quarks and so on. And NC is the number of, it is just NC gauge group. This means that we are living on the world volume of NC D3 brains. So, so we see that we could very precisely describe the geometry and field around our four-dimensional world in 10-dimensional space-time. It was to comment here why we are dealing with 10 dimension. What could imagine that there are many different dimensions, but it turns out that 10 dimension is selected by consistency condition for the string. So the quantization, self-consistent quantization of the string could be performed only in 10 dimensional space-time. Also, it one could have in mind a little bit rough picture, but it has some correct flavor that when you consider four dimensional 10 dimension, you could divide 10 in the following manner. We have a four dimensional space time, four dimensional momentum and energy. So we have coordinate, four dimensional space time, momenta and energy, four dimensional space time. Now we have 8, and the rest of two coordinates correspond to a very peculiar selection between the coordinates and momenta. When we quantize when we consider the quantum mechanics and go through the conventional quantum classical picture to quantum picture, it's necessary to consider polarization. So it's necessary to choose the we are dealing in coordinates or momentum, and it turns out that there is the manifold of selections between momenta and coordinates, and this is two-dimensional manifold. So in this manner, we get 10.
For bosonic string,
we should consider 26 instead of 10. So supersymmetry is important for the stuff here as well. Okay, so so let me now we have all ingredients here, and now we formulate the duality. The last point I would like to mention here, what is the symmetry of the geometry around the brain? And I guess everybody could guess the correct symmetry around in the for this geometry. So mathematically, it means the isometry of the manifold. It is SO24 times SO6. And you see the same objects on the left blackboard and right blackboard. Here it is the symmetry of the field theory, which has maximum amount of supersymmetry. And the same symmetry group is the symmetry of the geometry created by the stack of D3 brain. That is why this is actually the starting point of Maldacena conjecture, that when you consider some probe string in the following background, it captures the information about the n equals 4 supersymmetric Young-Mills theory on the world volume of D3 brains. So the duality connects the theory on the NC brains, which is just our gauge theory, it connects with the propagation of the probe string in the background created by this brain. So let me once again rephrase the analogy which I have mentioned yesterday, that if we would like to investigate some complicated black hole, well, black box, there is some non-trivial object inside. And what should we do? And what is the most natural object procedure to
to follow. Let us consider some scattering of some known object in the background created by this black box. And so we have something non-trivial, scatter the known object at this black box and look at the result of the scattering process. And here we have similar situation. Instead of this black box, we have our four-dimensional space-time. And instead of external object which scatters at our four-dimensional world, it is string, closed string. So closed string. And therefore, the duality can be formulated in the following manner. So we consider every phenomena which happens in the four-dimensional space-time on the both volume of this brain, there could be plenty of different complicated phenomena in our four-dimensional space-time, but all these non-trivial phenomena can be captured by a kind of scattering experiment. So we consider the closed string in the background of our four-dimensional world. And the duality claims that every phenomena in our four-dimensional world can be filled by the probe string. And this is the key idea, that using the probe in high-dimensional space-time created by our four-dimensional world, we would like to extract the information about very complicated, strongly coupled phenomena in our four-dimensional space-time. But okay, so this is the key point, that we, instead of, now we are ready to write down the right-hand side of the correspondence. We a little bit fixed our theory. I have already mentioned that the symmetry suggests the symmetry of the ADS 5 times S5 suggests which gauge theory we are dealing with. This is the maximally supersymmetric theory. Hence we consider strings theory propagating in geometry ADS 5 times S5 plus high rank form. So we consider string propagating in this geometry. How it described? It is a two-dimensional theory. So we relate the four-dimensional theory with a two-dimensional with two-dimensional theory on the world volume of the string. I guess you understand when you consider string, what we are doing, we consider two-dimensional theory on its world volume. When you consider the particle, let me repeat once again that when you consider the particle, we consider action is just m square root of x dot squared ds plus external field, and when you consider particle, and when you consider the string, the action, here we have tension, here we have considered external metric, which is just the metric written here. You see that integral is over the two-dimensional volt volume of the string. So it is nothing but two-dimensional sigma model. So the duality relates the four-dimensional theory with two-dimensional string theory on the volt volume on the string. But when you consider, of course, it's not the end of the story. It's the very beginning of the story. First of all, it's necessary to relate the parameters of of the series. Okay, so what is what are the natural parameters for string propagating in this non-trivial background? Well, there are a few of them. First of all, here we have tension of the string. It is coefficient instead of in front of the string action. Then the next point, what is it is the string coupling constant. This means this measures how the strings interact with each other. And also there is NC, which is just the flux of five-dimensional space-time. And these are parameters on the stringy side. And it's natural to ask what is the correspondence between the field theory parameters. And this correspondence is the key point for calculation. So here I've mentioned the ideology behind this correspondence. So we consider on the theory in the brain, it provides some non-trivial fields around and consider the probe propagating in the background of our four-dimensional world. The most simple point is that here is that if the identification of the flux of the gauge field, it is nothing but the rank of the group in the gauge on the gauge theory side. It's clear that to identify the flux of this five-form field, it's necessary to take into account the conventional Gauss law. So it's that is considered as an integral over five-form. In ADS geometry, it is nothing but NC. It is nothing but the Gauss law for higher rank field. The identification of string coupling constant, the gauge theory counterpart of string coupling constant. It is just the square of Young-Mills coupling constant. That is why we could relate the interaction of the string with interaction in the conventional gauge theory. And the most non-trivial identification is that the tension of the string. Okay, tension of the string is proportional square root of J Young-Mills squared times NC. This means that when you consider the strong coupling regime in the gauge theory, we consider the huge the string with a huge tension. The object with big tension, as you know in our conventional experience, when you consider heavy mass, it corresponds to the semi-classical object. And here we see that the same picture works as well. When we consider the string with a very big large tension, it is semi-classical object. So this is the key of the correspondence, This is the dictionary. And let me complete this lecture with mentioning with three different regimes, which are could be classified as follows. First, NC finite finite. So let us assume that we are working with a finite number of colors and the finite value of coupling constant. This corresponds to the most complicated situation when there is no simplification on the stringy side. This corresponds to the quantum string. The second limit, let us assume the so-called Hooft limit known in the conventional QCD. Let us assume that NC tend to infinity. However, G Young-Mills squared times NC is finite. Looking at this dictionary, you recognize immediately that what now we consider the semi-classical string without interaction. Gs tends to zero if you consider nc tends to infinity and the product is finite. This means the Young-Mills coupling constant tends to zero, and due to this dictionary, it corresponds that we are dealing with non-interacting strings. And finally, it's possible to consider strong coupling limit. This means that G Young-Mills squared NC tends to infinity. This means that we are dealing with semi-classical string, but it can be shown that in this limit only massless mode survive. This corresponds to classical supergravity. So, looking at different regimes, we could extract very non-trivial information about the gauge theory. And here we have a kind of duality. The most complicated regime from the gauge theory viewpoint, it is a large value of coupling constant. And on the other hand, it is the most simplest, most simple regime at the stringy type. So the strong coupling calculation in the gauge theory can be performed using very relatively simple technique in the two-dimensional sigma model or classical supergravity. So this is the key point and of the use of duality. Take the gauge theory in the strong coupling regime. Reformulate this theory as the theory on the probe. So once again, repeat, consider theory. It creates fields around. There is some probe. Take the theory on the probe. And it is much more simple. So I guess this is time to complete my second lecture. And tomorrow I'll describe how it works, how it could be used for calculation. So I hope you recognize the idea behind this duality, how it can be formulated, what is the dictionary between the parameters, and tomorrow I'll show how it works. Thank you.
Thank you. Both. So, questions?
In this duality picture, we can see that from one side there are three parameters, the tension, Gs, and NC. But from the other side, we can see only two parameters, g Young-Mills, n and c. Is it the one-to-one correspondence?
One-to-one.
Does it mean that gs is not the arbitrary function?
I write down here, it's not equal, it's proportional to the coupling constant. And here is, if you would like to count parameters, here we have additional parameter, one over string scale, so GL. So in this form, it could be exactly true, because this is dimensionless, and it is dimensionful. So the dimensionality should count the string scale here. So everything should be should have the proper scale behavior. So, I would like to emphasize dependence on these two parameters, and coupling constant and the number of colors. This is just the dimensional, provides the dimension.
Okay, thank you.
I have a few silly questions. Well, you said that we are living in a soliton that was generated in a brain. Yes, and does it mean that we live in a brain?
Yes.
We are
living on the brain, so I hope since now you know this important point.
And what does it mean to us, living in a brain? Something will change, or I don't know.
Our brain is our four-dimensional world. So your question is, could we feel the additional coordinates?
And some consequences.
Yeah, consequences. And the answer is yes, but we see the additional coordinates in a very non-trivial manner, as the vacuum expectation values, as the coupling constants, as parameters of our four-dimensional theory. But indeed, we feel high-dimensional space-time. But interpretation of this high dimension is very subtle point. So I tried not to enter the interpretation. But probably the best way is to take into account of as a kind of momentum space. But certainly, it's not clear how. And also, let me emphasize important point. Sometimes ago, it believed that string is the theory of everything. So, if stringy people claim that let us investigate string and this explain all everything, high dimension and all interaction and all this stuff. Here is the goal is more moderate. The string is the probe, so we consider our four-dimensional soliton brain we're living on, and probe our four-dimensional world with string propagating in the background of our world. So this is not the theory of everything. This is, but it's very effective tool to perform the calculation in our four-dimensional world. Like the Rutherford experiment, which I started my first lecture.
You just have to imagine these trees you bombard.
Oh, but it's necessary. But it's necessary to imagine to have some clear picture of this duality in your mind.
Sorry, another question.
Yeah.
I heard about a model, a cyclic model, when we have two brains and one is laying our universe and then brain strike to each other periodically, and what can you say
about that? In principle, you have a kind of Lego in your hands, so you have different brains, and when you consider periodic chain of brains you have mentioned, you have very peculiar properties on, first of all, it's possible to model in this manner some non-trivial properties of gravity, but on the other hand, it's possible to using this periodic structure to model the theories with different amount of supersymmetry. The most the important point is that we know we do not see supersymmetry yet. So somehow it's necessary to reduce amount of supersymmetry in this brain soliton picture. And it could be performed using, for instance, this periodic structure, some non-trivial boundary conditions. There are a lot of developments how to decrease amount of supersymmetry. And this is most important question, as periodic chain you have mentioned, it's one of this direction.
Sophisticated stuff. So, Mom?
You said that ADS5 times S5 geometry appears at NC tends to limit.
Yeah.
That tends to infinity limit.
Yeah.
And what about NC equals to 3?
Okay. So so generically the solution exists for any NC. So you could consider, but now. Now it's more complicated. So it's not ADS5 times S5. It's more complicated geometry, and it generically should correspond to a theory with a less amount of supersymmetry first. Then, since it has a finite number of flavors, colors, it corresponds to interacting. String. So there are a lot of complex features which appears when you consider finite NC. So in principle, there are some papers which where people try to get some SU3, standard model setup. But at the present, I guess there is no clean picture how. It should take some time of to get along the development of this paradigm to get the standard model. It's more complicated. It's complicated stuff since there is no supersymmetry, and this is the most difficult point to cure.
So we know how to solve the table with one leg or infinite number of legs is well known, but not with four legs, right?
Is it proof that duality exists in this case? Or
yeah. Yes. I
duality exists in every NC.
So let me once again.
Oh, it's proved that duality exists, or we believe that duality exists.
It exists. It's difficult to calculate. It's more difficult for calculation, but the picture is the same. Consider for what we are talking about. Let us consider SU3 just three braids. Here and once again consider the probe string in the background of the string. Nothing happens, but everything becomes much more complicated here. And in principle, when you consider finite NC, you just consider it's necessary to consider quantum string, and but the duality holds.
But
sure.
Still, this is a conjecture because you cannot check calculating here, calculating
there. For large NC,
yes,
for large NC, there are a lot of checks. There are no doubts that for large NC it works. Actually, there are no doubts that it works for finite NC, but it's much more difficult to provide the checks.
Sir, maybe you have mentioned that, but do we have to take into account the interaction of this closed string to other strings, to open strings, which are attached to these brains?
Okay, so your question is whether there is a open string correspond to just the gauge fields on the world volume on these brains. And your question is there interaction between a closed string with gauge fields? Of course, yes. So indeed, there is interaction. When you consider the string, it generically it propagates in external metric, in external high rank field. But if it is absorbed by the soliton, it's necessary to take into account the interaction with gauge field as well.
We had a question here.
You?
Nobody. Some.
Yeah. I have a question.
Hand was raised.
I have a question, but it's a kind of common question. Can you get the gauge fields from the brains? Like, can you reduce your higher dimensional space-time to our four-dimensional space-time and that the presence of these extra dimensions will lead to the emergence of gauge fields in our four-dimensional?
Actually, if I would like to discuss purely the gauge fields only, you could restrict, to some extent, yourself by the four-dimensional theory on the world volume. The scalar field, this is, when you consider the weak coupling phenomena, we could forget about the higher dimension when you consider purely gauge sector. But when you take into account strong coupling phenomena, it turns out the strong coupling phenomena in the gauge theory sector is very sensitive to higher dimensional space time. So in weak coupling, you could, at the first approximation, you can forget about higher dimension. But when you take into account the strong coupling phenomena, you cannot forget it. And tomorrow I'll discuss how actually it works and how strong coupling phenomena in the gauge theory can be captured by additional coordinates. And let me, one simple comment here. When you consider IDS5, you have one additional coordinate. What is the meaning of this coordinate? The answer is maybe trivial, maybe non-trivial. I do not know what you're feeling on this point. It is the scale, the energy scale in your theory. So when you consider the different values of radial coordinate in IDS5, you consider your four-dimensional theory at different energy scales. And the motion in this additional coordinate corresponds to randomization group flow in four-dimensional theory. So when you consider quantum properties of gauge theories, it's unavoidable to consider fixed dimensions because of randomization group flow.
I see you can get the scalar fields, but I guess vector fields also, but what about fermions?
Fermions, when you consider supersymmetric situation, fermions come in pairs with bosonic degrees of freedom, but generically when you consider brains, there are fermions localized on the brain. So actually your question concerns the localization of fermionic degrees of freedom on the brain. Indeed, maybe you know the examples of domain walls, and there are localization of fermions on the domain walls. Here we have the same phenomena.
All right, thank you very much. I'm afraid we have to stop discussion for today.